Well, let's take this out. So I'm very glad to be here to present you this work. My talk will be mainly based on a collaboration with Thomas Weber that is here with us. Let me stress that I'm very glad to participate to this cost action event. So of this page, the most important thing is cost action Callisto. So what I will talk is about the problem in non-commutative Riemannian geometry of devising a Levi-Civita connection given associated to a metric. Devo cliccare, ma non funziona. Qui devo cliccare. Ah, scusa. Okay. So, on one hand, non-commutative differential geometry has done big steps in the last 30 years, let's say. I'm here taking the approach of quantum algebras. And we can definitely, explicitly, when we can consider non-commutative algebras that are deformations of affine varieties, where there are notions of differential calculi. We have many times seen in this Congress the notion of connection. Associated to it, there is a notion of curvature, of torsion. When it comes to non-commutative Riemannian geometry, well, we have to introduce a metric. And the first question is, what is a metric? And then another point on which the community is still working on is the metric compatibility condition. So you see, let's in the present work, we will clarify these two points and take a specific approach. But let me start somehow describing the literature according to how the metric is considered on quantum algebras. Well, let me give you an example. When you take a round sphere, like SU, the three sphere group, what is the metric that you would like to take on the three sphere? The first thing you think of is the round metric. Okay, so here we have a non-commutative algebra, so that can be taught as an algebra with some non-commutative structure. And the first thing one can think of is a metric that is compatible with such non-commutativity. And that's the very natural thing to be done. But there is also another approach. And coming back to the tree sphere is that of saying, but what about if I squash the tree sphere? What about if I consider oscillations of the round metric? And in that case, I would like to have the metric independent from the non-commutativity. And that's exactly the case when you want to consider the metric a dynamical field. Now, in gravity, the metric is a dynamical field. One of my motivations for considering non-commutative geometry, as has been said in this conference, is considering a non-commutative gravity theory where the metric is possibly a dynamical field with the same degrees of freedom as in the classical case in first approximation. So what I've just said for the metric can be said also for another structure on such quantum algebra is that of connections. And indeed, the two things go together. Metric that is central, that is compact, is commutes with the algebra, goes along, as we have seen yesterday in the talk of Bonvic with the idea of a connection that is a bimodal connection. And again, if you want to think of a connection as a dynamical field, maybe you want to be more general than bimodal connections. So here are a list of results, selected results in the literature, where the first results are obtained with metrics that are compatible with the non-commutativity, or if there is some group actions on such algebras with the quantum group actions, H is a Hopf algebra in this slide. And so we have works of Majid, Bex. Yesterday we have heard of the works of Bonvic, Goswami, and Landi. Weber has been treated a case of algebras that are compatible with triangular Hopf algebras and considered H covariant matrix and connections there. And then there are some other compatibility conditions, kind of strong ones on quantum groups due to Bonvic and Mukhopadhyay, and less strong compatibility conditions in a recent work of Arnlind, Hill, Weil, and Landi. Now, if on the other hand you want to go with a metric that is arbitrary, well, the result is that typically you have to reduce to go to simple example in non-commutative in quantum algebras. And to give you some examples, the group in Munich of Vess worked on the non-commutative theta plane. Similar result works for the non-commutative torus due to Rosenberg. Here the metric is a completely arbitrary symmetric of tensor in that algebra. For a brilliant Drinfeld twist, so in deformation quantization, there are other results together with Leonardo Castellani. For the three sphere, theta sphere, there is a result by Arndt and Wilson. And what I would like to say in just one slide is that in this direction of considering non-commutative algebras that are of special kind, but metrics that are completely arbitrary, the problem has been fully solved for algebras that are braided commutative in the sense that the commutation between two elements in the algebra is governed by an R matrix. An R matrix that belongs to a triangular Hopf algebra acting on this algebra. No? So A is an A module algebra and there is a triangular Hopf algebra H. In this case, there is a canonical calculus. The differential geometry has been well studied. The key point is that in this case, the notion of connection lifted to the tensor product of two one forms where the metric lives is a notion that needs a braiding itself. So the connection is really braiding through the various one forms here, omega and eta. And in this context, I've been proving that there is a unique exists and it's unique, the Levi-Civita connection associated to a metric. In particular, this context applies to triangular Hopf algebras. You take a triangular Hopf algebras there, you know that you have a Levi-Civita connection for any braided symmetric metric. So the natural question is, can we relax this triangularity condition? And what I would like to talk tell you today is a way to relax the triangularity condition and go to a general Hopf algebra, not even quasi triangular, a general Hopf algebra. In particular, I'm thinking as the example of SLQ2. And for future work, homogeneous spaces of triangular, quasi-triangular Hopf algebras. Sorry, Hopf algebras. Now, why I consider exactly Hopf algebras? Because our Hopf algebras are very rich. There is a big covariant calculus Lavrovanovich on them, are well understood object from the differential geometry point of view. So let's put also on such a rigid, rich structure, also a metric structure, and see what can be done in that rich context. So the goal of today's talk, and as I said, this is work together with Thomas Weber, is first to discuss the metric compatibility condition, and to show you that there is an existent uniqueness result for metrics that are neither central, so neither bimodule maps, nor equivariant or co-invariant. So they have no compatibility condition with the quantum group of the Hopf algebra itself. The main tools toward achieving this result is understanding the sum of connection, that is lifting the connection on a vector on forms to connection on tensor product of forms. In the general case of just the right connection without considering bimodule connections. And then following a work by Bonvic and Mukhopadhyay, the idea that at least for simple quantum, core semi-simple quantum groups of the ABCD series, there is the possibility of having a Voronovich braiding that is fully diagonalized. So, entering the more technical aspects of the talk, I divide it in two parts. I will speak of bicovariant bimodules, one forms and vector fields belong there. I will have to talk briefly of rational morphism and will explain why. This first part will allow me to describe the sum of connection. Once I also introduce the decomposition in symmetric and antisymmetric parts, so to say, of the space of one form tensor one forms, we will go directly to the Riemannian geometry theorems. So we work with a Hopf algebra with invertible antipod over a field K. We consider the Voronovich-Bicovarian differential calculus on such a Hopf algebra. In particular, the space of one forms is a bicovariant bimodule. Okay, so we have functions multiply on forms, but there is also the Hopf algebra coaction corresponding to the group action. And because I am bimodule, form a nice category. I can take tensor product over H of bicovariant bimodules, and they are still bicovariant bimodules, so it's a monoidal category. And there is a braiding, the canonical braiding studied by Voronovich. I take a left covariant form and right covariant form, the braiding just flip the two, and then is extended as an AB linear map. Here is the general expression. But furthermore, considering HOM, of two bicovariant bimodules, that is right H linear maps, if you want. Well, this is again a bicovariant bimodule. And this tells me that there is an internal HOM functor in this category. It's nice to say, observe that this category, everything is symmetric with respect to left and right. And here I'm taking right linear maps. And indeed, the left and right module of this bicovariant bimodule is done only with the left actions of M and N. Mm? So there is a the symmetry is preserved. Okay. I will, in the next slides, use this notation for the braiding, mm? Just two sums over these indexes alpha. Okay, so given that we have such a close braided monoidal category, we can introduce a product that I call tensor sigma Voronovich, and that has this nice property. You see, on the left-hand side, I have a bicovariant bimodule, another bicovariant bimodule, and a third bicovariant bimodule. Phi tensor H psi is an element of a bicovariant bimodule. I want to think of it as a map. Classically, it's automatically a map. In this quantum context, I have to operate with this tensor product morphism in order to think of this as a map. You see, now I can evaluate phi tensor sigma omega psi on element M tensor N. Here is the expression of this map, and following Majid, this is an associative product. Once we have this map, in particular, we can consider the extension of a map phi to M tensor M. Okay, so this is, would be the sum of phi with phi. It's the usual Leibniz rule, if we want. Now, the point of this talk is that we would like to do this. So we would like to have this sum phi tensor identity plus identity tensor phi with a connection, not with a right H linear element here. Okay? So can we do this with a connection? Well, a connection is not an element here. So we have to some extent generalize what is written in this slide. What does it mean, generalize? That I still have bicovariant bimodules, but instead of the tensor product over the Hopf algebra, I take the tensor product over the base ring, that is a field. Instead of this, I will have to take just linear maps from M to N. Connection is a linear map. And I will have to find some lift of this product here that I call like that. So in the next slides, I tell you how to construct all this. How I'm doing with the timing? 12 minutes, thank you. So let me give you just the idea, okay? In order to give you the idea, it's enough to consider right H comodules, okay? The point is that when I have a map from N to N that is just linear, on which there is a coaction of H here, there is a coaction of H here, there is classically, canonically, an action of the group on phi, the adjoint action. And here one would like to have the adjoint coaction on H here. This is not in general always possible because the adjoint coaction that is written here ends up in a space that is bigger than what we would like. But one can cure this. One can restrict linear maps in such a way that they end up in this space rather than in this space. This is possible, has been studied, for example, by Ulbricht, by Canapelle as well. And we will call the subspace of linear maps that has this property and therefore that is a right H comodule, we will call it the subspace of rational morphisms from M to N. So these are linear maps, nothing more than linear maps, and can be thought as inside here. They behave very well, okay? They are, as a matter of fact, make this a closed category. Moreover, this with this tensor product and with This rational morphism is a closed monoidal category. Furthermore, if instead of just a H comodule, I have an H comodule that is also an H module, well, then I can think of taking here inside the morphism that are also, besides being rational, are H linear, right H linear. Well, this is nothing else than the usual right H linear morphisms. So this is works very nicely. And similarly, what I've said can be applied to bicovariant bimodules. Okay, now we are ready to understand, to start attacking this problem. And to attack this problem, we have to see how the braiding can be lifted to some other map. And here is the choice we make. We have a lifting of the braiding to tensor product over K, not over H. And you see, it's just the same expression, but we remove the tensor product over H. Well, this turns out to be a morphism just in this category, not in that of bicovariant bimodules. Don't worry. The tensor product that we define here is actually a morphism in the category of bicovariant bimodule. It's not an isomorphism, but it's good for our aims. And out of this, we can induce what we need, that is a morphism between bicovariant bimodules, where I stress it here, this is a bicovariant bimodule, this is a bicovariant bimodule, and here I have the bicovariant bimodule of K linear rational morphism from the tensor product over H of M and N to the tensor product over H of M prime and N prime. And this is an associative morphism in the category of bicovariant bimodules. And this is what we want in the sense that if phi and psi are right H linear, then this becomes exactly this. So it's a lift of this, okay? So having achieved that, we can address the problem of constructing the sum of connection. You recall the problem was being able to do this game for connections rather than right H linear maps. And here we come. So we have seen many times the notion of a connection. As I said, I consider just the notion of a right connection on the bicovariant bimodule of one forms. Here is the definition of a right connection. And the right connection can be immediately extended to this module using the exterior differential. And already we see a first application of this tensor hat product. This extension can be written in a more operatorial way, in this way. And here I want to stress that both this addend and this addend are well defined on maps. Okay. Okay. So this is promising. Let's continue this study of connection. I think I can skip this part because we have been considering, seeing what a curvature of a connection is, and similarly also yesterday what the torsion of a connection is. These are standard definitions that works well also in the non-commutative case. What I want to stress is that given that we are working with bicovariant bimodules, there are canonical connections on such very rich modules. They are free. And in particular, there is a canonical connection that I call that we call DM, that is simply defined by saying that it vanishes on left covariant elements, left covariant elements are what I call inv M. Okay? So this is defines a connection. There is also another connection that is due to the very rich structure of having a bicovariant bimodule, and is obtained out of the structure constants. Okay, if these are the structure constant defining the exterior derivative of omega kappa, let's say, is a basis of this free module of one forms, well, then this connection here is a torsion-free connection, canonical torsion-free connection, like in group theory. Okay, now the first result. Any connection on bicovariant bimodule, any connection on bicovariant bimodule is a rational morphism. Okay, so we are in this set here. That's very easy. This is a rational morphism because it's right co-invariant, and any connection is obtained from this adding a right H-linear map. Now we can define the sum of connection using this tensor head product. Here is the formula. So this is the connection on the tensor product module. Is this a well-given definition? Yes. For the canonical connections, I do the sum of the canonical connection on module N, the canonical connection on module N, I automatically get the canonical connection on the tensor product. So this perfectly matches. This ends the first part, but there was the non-trivial part. Now, one very fast slide on the fact that for the ABCD series of quantum groups, we have a direct sum decomposition in antisymmetric and symmetric parts. And this also reverberates on the dual module of vector fields. And here is the definition of metric CVT, metric compatible connection. So a connection is metric compatible if, first of all, I lift it to the tensor product. But that's not enough. What I have to do is not to consider a connection on forms, tensor forms, but to consider a connection on the symmetric forms that I denote with a V, opposite of a wedge. And to do that, I have to take a projection. In the classical case, there's no need of such a projection. In this quantum case, it is needed. Okay, so I obtain a connection on symmetric forms, and then the condition for a connection to be Levi-Civita is that this connection on symmetric forms has to be compatible with the metric. Here is the condition. So this is the metric compatibility and the torsion freeness condition. And the metric in this context, what it is an arbitrary symmetric tensor. So it's just left, right A-linear. It's not central, not bilinear. Okay, in this setting, we have two results. The first is that provided that this map that you see is a map that depends on the metric, but not on the differential of the metric. So it's a map between bimodules, it's a right module map. So one can check whether it is invertible or not. Provided this map is invertible, then it exists a unique connection, Levi-Civita connection. Here is the statement. And it is obtained inverting it and considering the torsion-free connection, canonical torsion-free connection on bimodules. The other result is, can we go farther and have a criterion for saying whether this is invertible or not without looking at the metric? Yes, we can. Provided the metric is central and bicovariant, so it's a very strict requirement, then provided that a certain map that is here, that is constructly simply out of Voronovich braiding, is invertible, and typically it is, then we are able to say that there is an invertible metric. It's a proof through a commutative diagram of isomorphisms. Result, due to the very careful categorical analysis I've explained here, we can extend this theorem and say that as soon as we have a metric that has Levi-Civita connection, then a Weyl-Rescaled metric with F any invertible function in the Hopf algebra H, then also this has Levi-Civita connection. So you see, tell me a metric, for example, a central B-invariant metric, and I construct a whole one-parameter family of metrics that admit Levi-Civita condition. So here you see we gain again some dynamical degrees of freedom, the one degrees of freedom of this invertible function. I conclude with this example, SLQ2. There, all the conditions for having a central invertible, a central and B co-invariant matrix are satisfied. Taking an invertible element F, we have a Levi-Civita Levi-Civita connection for such matrix. With this, I thank you for your attention.
But I want to ask you firstly, omega one wedge of cup omega one, is that the same as what Francisco and I call this omega two F, the kernel of the wedge product? Is that the same thing?
Is isomorphic to that. Let me show you. So we assume that the braiding as among its eigenvalues as one. And then we take this as the space of symmetric, and all the rest is the antisymmetric.
When you
have
a quantum SL2, there is a very natural invariant, it has an organized property, it's a very natural invariant metric. And there is, I think that your conditional metric compatibility went by a bit too quickly, but I think it implies it should all be co-torsion free. That the connection is Levi-Civita in your sense. I think it will also be co-torsion free. On then in that example, there is a unique co-torsion free left connection. So I would like to know if you claim the same answer.
Well, we have been thinking about that because of this result that you have. But on one hand, if I correctly recall, in this case, you consider a weak metric compatibility condition. We have not been able to make the exact correspondence because this is an existence and uniqueness result. But then to have explicit construction is it takes some effort.
And hello again.